This is the video lecture on adjusting entries. Whenever you talk about the adjusting entries, you first have to talk about the accounting period. And this has to do with time periods. You'll recall from an earlier video, we talked about the time period principle. And basically, the time period principle says that for accounting purposes, we can divide time into various time periods. And that's very useful in accounting because sometimes a company would like to generate reports that will explain to everyone exactly how the company performed during a particular time period. And it really is up to that company to make a decision about how many time periods per year that they want to use for their reporting. So in the overall realm of possibilities, with time periods, we have many different ones to choose from. And the first time period would simply be annual. And this would actually be the bare minimum because companies are actually required to publish their financial statements at least once a year. So that would be the bare minimum of an annual reporting period. And then if they want to report more frequently, that would be up to the individual company. But they could choose to go with a semi-annual reporting period, which would mean twice per year or every 6 months. It's also a pretty popular option to go with quarterly time periods, in which case you would be actually publishing the statements every 3 months or 4 times per year. And probably the most common is monthly, where you would have financial statements that are published every single month. In fact, all the examples that we're going to take a look at in this particular lecture are going to be monthly examples. But you're not even limited to that. You could even go with semi-monthly, weekly, or even daily. So it really just depends on the company. It depends on what their goals are and if they feel that it's worthwhile to report more often and they get a benefit out of doing that, then they can make that decision and have reporting periods that are in very frequent time spans throughout the year. Now, the actual adjusting process, the first thing to talk about would be, when do I do the adjusting process? How often do I have to go through this? Well, this actually has to be performed at the end of every accounting period. So again, it depends on the company. If I'm following an annual reporting period, then I would only do the adjustments once a year. But if I was following, say, a monthly accounting period, I would do these adjustments every single month or 12 times a year. And in fact, like I said before, all the examples that we're going to take a look at in this video are going to be monthly adjustments. Also, at what point do I start this process? Well, actually, before I start the adjustments, I would have already completed the general journal entries, the T accounts, and the trial balance. So all the things that we did in our demo problem and all the things that we did in the homework assignment, we did that. We did the general journal entries, the T accounts, and the trial balance. So this would be immediately following that trial balance. Now, when I begin the adjustment process, I have to identify certain accounts that need to be adjusted. And one of the accounts that always has to be adjusted are any prepaid expenses. Anytime a company has paid in advance for one of their expenses, that's always an adjustment. So if you take a look at this example, in this case, this business on December the 1st paid $1,200 for 1 year of insurance coverage. Well, that's a prepayment, paying for 1 year in advance. It says the company follows a monthly reporting period, so an adjusting entry is necessary on December 31st. Now, the way these prepaid expenses work is that initially, they are an asset, but as the time passes, it begins to expire, and that asset turns into an expense. And you'll notice they paid $1,200, and it's for 1 year or 12 months of coverage. So $1,200 divided by 12 works out to $100 per month. So this is going to require a $100 adjustment. So now you get to see the actual entry itself. We would debit insurance expense and credit prepaid insurance for $100. And by doing so, we not only show the expense, but we show that the asset is actually being reduced. The original balance of prepaid insurance was $1,200, and once this entry is booked, it would lower that asset down to $1,100. And that's exactly what it needs to be, because there are 11 months left on that insurance policy. So that's a classic example of the adjusting entry for a prepaid expense. And even though this one happened to be prepaid insurance, you would do a very similar adjustment for any prepaid expense that the business might have. The next adjustment would be supplies. Any company that has a supplies account definitely has to do this adjustment. Now, the way the supplies work is that initially they are an asset, but over time the supplies are actually used up, and once they are used, they turn into an expense. So if you take a look at this example, this company is starting out with $2,000 in their supplies. It's now the end of the month of December, and now they have to take a physical inventory of the supplies. And what they have found is that there are $800 of supplies remaining. So that requires an adjustment. I have an asset that has a $2,000 balance, and it needs to have an $800 balance. So I need to take care of that in this journal entry and show the expense at the same time. So the difference between the $2,000 and the $800, that's a difference of $1,200. So here's the journal entry that would be required. I will debit supplies expense, $1,200, and credit supplies, $1,200. And what that does is it not only shows the expense, but it also lowers the asset. Remember, if I credit an asset, that lowers it. So it's going to take that $2,000 balance all the way down to $800, which is what we want it to be. The next adjustment is for depreciation. Now, there are certain assets that we own that we have to depreciate. And the assets that get depreciated are the long-term assets. These are assets that we're going to not only own, but we're also going to use these assets in the business, and we're going to use these for many years. Now, what GAAP requires is that these type of assets must be depreciated. So what does that mean, to depreciate? What it really means is to take the expense and spread it out over the lifespan of the asset, rather than actually show all the expense at once. So that is a GAAP requirement for our long-term assets. Now, we're going to find out later on in the semester that there are actually different ways to calculate depreciation. But initially, we're just going to learn one of the ways. So initially, the method that we're going to learn is called straight-line depreciation. And this is a very, very popular, very common method. And it's also the most straightforward. And that's probably why it's so commonly used. It's a very straightforward and very simple formula. It is the cost minus salvage value divided by useful life in years. So it's literally that easy to calculate the straight line depreciation. And of course, we've talked about this before, that cost, it is going to be the actual cost, the actual price paid, And then, of course, we would have to come up with an opinion about the salvage value, which is the value at the end of the lifespan. And also, we'd have to have an opinion about the lifespan. How many years is this particular asset going to last? So if we know all three of those items, we could plug that into this equation and actually calculate the straight line depreciation. So to see how this would actually work in an example, we've got a company here that has purchased $20,000 worth of equipment on the very first day of December. And what are their expectations? Well, they expect the equipment to have a $1,000 salvage value and a useful life of about 10 years. So based on that information, we could record the adjustment for depreciation as of December 31st. Now bear in mind, we're going to be using the straight line formula. It's cost minus salvage divided by years. But there's also something else we have to bear in mind, and that is, remember our reporting period. This company uses a monthly reporting period. And I've only owned this machine from December 1st to December 31st. So I only want to take 1 month's worth of depreciation. So a lot of people have a tendency to just take the $20,000, deduct $1,000, that would be $19,000, and then you divide that by 10, and you get $1,900. But I don't want to do the journal entry for $1,900. Actually, I want to do the journal entry for $158. Now, where does that come from? That is the annual amount divided by 12. So you see how your time period actually has an effect on the adjustments. If you didn't remember to do that, you would be taking an entire year's worth of depreciation in 1 month, and that wouldn't be appropriate. So this is rounded. This is the amount per month. It is the 1900 divided by 12. And then what titles do we use? Well, we debit depreciation expense and we credit accumulated depreciation. So this is an expense account, and this account will show how much accumulation we have on the asset in terms of its depreciation. So that would be the appropriate way to record that. And like I said, that's just one possibility. That's using straight line. Later on in the semester, we'll actually learn about some other possible methods that we might use for depreciation.